On Wednesday, the United States government offered an unprecedented $5 million reward for information leading to the arrest and conviction of exiled Saudi millionaire Osama bin Laden and his military commander. That followed a 238-count indictment against the two men. They are charged with leading a worldwide terror network. That network, federal officials say, masterminded the bombings of U.S. embassies in Africa this past summer and tried to obtain components for nuclear and chemical weapons. CNN's Peter Bergen, one of few Western journalists to interview bin Laden, provides an exclusive look inside his network.
Terrorist bombs destroy the U.S. embassies in Kenya and Tanzania. Islamic militant Osama bin Laden quickly becomes suspect number one. Last week, he was indicted for the bombings.
Osama bin Laden and his military commander, Mohammed Atif, are charged with plotting and carrying out the most heinous acts of international terrorism and murder.
Quite a change from the Saudi billionaire's son, who became a hero of the 1980s war in Afghanistan, leading a group of fighters from around the world against the Soviet invaders. So what turned bin Laden against the United States? After the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait in 1990, bin Laden made the rulers of his native Saudi Arabia an offer. He and his followers would take on the Iraqis.
And he took to the Saudi authorities, trying to convince them that he can arrange a plan to defend Arabia if the country cannot do it.
Dr. Saad Faghi is a leading opponent of the Saudi government. He lives in exile in London. He says when the Saudis rejected bin Laden's offer, turning instead to the United States for help, bin Laden was outraged.
He said that we don't need to rely on quote-unquote infidels like the Americans to protect us.
And the date those U.S. troops were sent to Saudi Arabia? August 7th, 1990. 8 years to the day before the embassy bombings in Kenya and Tanzania. The Saudis expelled the increasingly anti-American bin Laden in 1992. He took his inherited fortune, estimated at hundreds of millions of dollars, and settled in Sudan. The U.S. State Department says he set up training camps for terrorists in Sudan and began targeting American troops based in nearby Somalia.
It was also an objective of the charged conspiracy to kill members of the U.S. military serving in Somalia in 1992 and 1993.
Bin Laden admitted that his followers were involved when CNN interviewed him in Afghanistan last year.
Arabs who had fought in Afghanistan cooperated with their Somali brothers and killed large numbers of Americans.
Among those now accused of planning a holy war in Somalia is a man from Alexandria, Egypt, who has been working with bin Laden since 1986. That man, according to the U.S. indictment, was Mohammed Atef, bin Laden's military commander. Bin Laden's biographer remembers first meeting this man in the company of bin Laden.
He was introduced to me by Osama bin Laden, and he said that he was my commander in Somalia, commander of my troops who fought against the American troops, and he destroyed one American helicopter also.
That was during this infamous 1993 firefight where 18 U.S. Army Rangers and hundreds of Somalis were killed. U.S. bodies were dragged through the streets of Mogadishu. The Americans pulled out. Bin Laden claimed his first victory against the United States.
The Americans ran away. We learned from those who fought there of the low morale of the American fighters.
Over the next few years, bin Laden's anti-Western rhetoric escalated. By 1997, he was threatening to attack more American soldiers.
We have focused our declaration of holy war on U.S. soldiers in Saudi Arabia.
From his new base in Afghanistan, bin Laden expanded his network worldwide, operating in 22 countries. It's now estimated he has a core of hundreds of followers in Afghanistan and as many as 10,000 foot soldiers around the globe. Abdul Bari Atwan is the editor of an Arabic newspaper who has spent time with bin Laden.
They were well trained, and all of them would like to die immediately because this is their hope, this is their aim in order to go to paradise.
Last February, as the United States was preparing to launch further military strikes against Iraq, bin Laden issued what he termed a fatwa, a religious opinion, shown here in its original form. The fatwa, which was circulated internationally, called for the deaths of American civilians anywhere in the world. Other groups that signed on to the fatwa include radical organizations from Egypt, Pakistan, and Bangladesh. It created for the first time an international coalition of Islamic radicals.
I believe it is a deadly coalition and it should be taken very, very seriously.
Then in May, bin Laden and his colleagues went public, holding a press conference in eastern Afghanistan. Journalist Ismail Khan was there. He says that bin Laden's arrival was quite a show.
And then I saw three cars coming and these hooded guys escorting Osama. And then Osama came out of the car, and the moment he stepped out, there was shooting, you know, frenzy, shooting in the air, and these guys firing RPGs, rocket-propelled grenades in the mountains.
This is the leadership. Bin Laden is in the middle. On one side, his trusted military commander, the man the U.S. identifies as Mohammed Atef, now charged with bin Laden for plotting the embassy bombings in Africa. On the other side, his close friend and personal physician, Dr. Ayman al-Zawahiri, head of the Egyptian paramilitary group Islamic Jihad. He was convicted of involvement in the 1981 assassination of Egypt's president Anwar Sadat.
I believe Ayman al-Zawahiri managed to influence bin Laden to enlarge his activities and to turn more to violence.
Also at the May conference, two other important players not shown in the photo, the sons of this man, Sheikh Omar Abdul Rahman. Rahman's spiritual followers blew up the World Trade Center in 1993. And he was convicted of inspiring plans for a terrorist spree in New York. CNN has learned that Sheikh Rahman has written his will. According to those who have seen the will, it urges his sons to seek revenge on the United States. CNN has also learned that the sons, Omar and Asim, have now joined up with bin Laden. Ismail Khan spoke to one of them at the press conference.
He said that he would follow into the footprints of his father and he would continue the jihad.
Now, at this press conference, did Osama bin Laden imply that there was going to be some kind of violent action shortly?
Yes, I mean, this thing still buckles my mind. You know, he spoke of some good news in the weeks ahead.
Then, 3 months later, according to the U.S. government, bin Laden struck. On a Friday morning in August, suicide bombs hit the U.S. embassies in Kenya and Tanzania. At least 224 people died. Thousands more were injured. According to a spokesman, bin Laden denies any involvement in the bombing. He also declined an interview request from CNN. It took a lucky break at this Pakistani airport to begin unraveling what is now called a terror conspiracy. A badly forged passport provided the first clues about the bombers. One of the men now charged, Mohammed Odeh, left Kenya just hours before the bombings and tried to enter Pakistan with a false passport.
And I must say that for once our immigration authorities were very efficient. He was apparently interrogated by our security people and he did make a confession.
Odeh later confessed to US officials that he was part of bin Laden's organization in Kenya, but denied any direct role in the bombings. Another suspect provided a more detailed account of how bin Laden's organization was involved in the bombings. Less than 2 weeks later, the Clinton administration decided it had enough evidence to strike back.
Our mission was clear, to strike at the network of radical groups affiliated with and funded by Osama bin Laden.
The United States launched military attacks on targets in Sudan and Afghanistan.
On the night of August 20th, in the mountains about 50 miles southwest of here, the night sky was illuminated by the explosions of over 50 cruise missiles targeting what the United States government called terrorist training camps.
Six camps in all were hit. Reports from Afghanistan indicate over 20 people were killed, but the main targets, bin Laden and the other leaders of the network, escaped unharmed. alerted to the possible attack by the earlier withdrawal of U.S. Embassy personnel from neighboring Pakistan.
Osama is a pretty shrewd guy, you know. He knew already, you know, that the Americans had evacuated their diplomats.
This student was in one of the camps. He says he was badly burned by a cruise missile. And he insists the only thing going on in his camp was religious instruction. But one of the camps, known as Al-Badar, is directly controlled by bin Laden, according to visitors to the camp. This photo, taken last year at the Al-Badar camp, shows weapons training in progress.
Our investigative strategy is clear. We will identify, locate, and prosecute all those responsible right up the line.
The U.S. is now offering a $5 million reward for information leading to the arrest of bin Laden. But bin Laden, a multimillionaire, has his own resources to fund his activities. And the U.S. missile attack has made him even more of a hero to some in the Islamic world. At bookstores in Pakistan, days after the attack, biographies of bin Laden went on sale. Maulana Samir ul Haq runs the largest religious school in Pakistan.
He's become a symbol for the whole Islamic world. All those outside powers who are trying to crush Muslims, he is the courageous one who raised his voice against them. He's a hero to us, but it is America who first made him a hero.
A hero to some, but many say more dangerous than ever.
On Friday after that attack, we received a call from bin Laden, top eight, and he told us that Sheikh Osama bin Laden is safe, and he is in a safe place. And he said, you know, we would like to tell President Clinton that we will answer these raids with actions, not with words.